Hi, I'm Mike Wargo. Columbia is back home in Florida following a record-breaking round trip. The first United States microgravity laboratory mission came to an end about 6:45 Central Time this morning. We'll talk about the longest space shuttle mission in history and the science that came home with it on Today in Space. Good morning from NASA's Marshall Space Flight Center in Huntsville, Alabama. STS-50, the United States Microgravity Laboratory mission, was the first flight on a shuttle fitted with equipment that's needed to stay in space for extended periods of time. That's significant because longer flights mean more time to do more science in microgravity or the free fall of Earth orbit. It's the kind of work that will be done aboard Space Station Freedom. When Columbia came home today, it was indeed another step toward permanent presence in space. This morning, Columbia made its first landing ever at the Kennedy Space Center in Florida. It touched down just a short distance from the launch pad from which this extended mission started about 2 weeks ago. It was quite an impressive round trip, one that racked up more than 5,700,000 miles. We have this report.
Columbia sailed through the morning sky to a spectacular touchdown at its alternate landing site, the Kennedy Space Center, a triumphant ending to a 14-day mission that takes its place in history books as the longest shuttle mission to date and the first flight of the United States Microgravity Laboratory.
Congratulations on the longest shuttle flight on record. Thanks for helping to pave the way to space station operations.
Okay, and I even think we got past Gemini 7, but with a lot more comfort, I'll tell you that.
Breaking new ground, this extremely successful science mission has returned an unprecedented range of data on physical and biological processes in microgravity. Since the seven-member crew blasted into orbit 14 days ago, a continuous stream of images has fascinated earthbound scientists with dramatic views of spinning liquid drops, bursts of flame, faceted crystals, and so much more.
I can tell you those crystals are right now about 6/10 to 7/10 of a millimeter in size, and they're going to grow a lot bigger before we're coming down from orbit.
This is NASA's Marshall Space Lab Mission Operations Control Center in Huntsville, the nerve center for science operations. Here, scientists worked around the clock, monitoring their experiments and guiding the space lab crew. Scientific investigators have called this area home for the last 14 days, living off a steady diet of coffee, junk food, and a stream of downlink data that marks the culmination of years of preparation and research.
The excitement of getting the data in here, but the actual science now has taken on its own life, and we expect to be getting results from this for many months and years to come.
Many investigators, those with perishable samples aboard the orbiter, left Huntsville earlier this week for the landing site. But while the work for the astronauts has ended, for the scientists on the ground, the real challenge is just beginning. In the months and the years ahead, these scientists, acting as detectives, will work to decipher their data and unlock the mysteries of experiments performed in microgravity.
Early in that report, you heard Commander Dick Richards refer to Gemini 7. That has a special significance. Gemini 7 was an extended mission early in the space program. It flew in December 1965 with astronauts Frank Borman and Jim Lovell at the controls of a small, cramped spacecraft. Job one on this mission was science, specifically microgravity science. USML-1 program scientist Dr. Roger Crouch joins us now to look back over the events from this laboratory in space. Roger, it looks like we've really come a long way.
Yeah, we really have, Mike. When this program started back in the early days of manned spaceflight, there were a lot of little handheld experiments that the astronauts would carry up with them. Even on the Gemini flight that you talked about, there were a couple of little fluids experiments. Then for a while, we got into the mode where we were talking about factories in space and materials processing. And what we soon found out was that to deliver large amounts of hardware and large amounts of raw materials on orbit took too much power, too much money. And so what we've got evolved to after the Challenger program is a program that looks at basic research up there in applied fields that we can bring back down here and bring into the research community here on Earth and help advance the state of the art in a lot of different disciplines. The thing that is really exciting about this mission for us is that it's sort of a, after 86, when Bonnie Dunbar did her report and requested that NASA install these USML missions, we sort of went into a replanning mode. And what we've done now is, this is the first fruition of that. We had the IML-1 mission in January. We got the USML-1 mission now that's just ended. And then we've got the USMP, which is a cargo bay mission that flies later on this fall. And we're really starting to get some results that has had a lot of planning going into it, where we're really looking at basic science. So we're really excited about that. The other thing that we've done is that we've got payload specialists on there who are experts in that area. We have a management program that lets us build hardware. The hardware that was on this flight, there were several pieces that were had never flown before. Three major pieces of hardware, the deep drop physics module, the surface tension driven, and the crystal growth furnace, all of which work perfectly. So we're really excited about our ability now to build hardware, take it up there, do operations in space, and it's sort of a window into the space station that we're looking at. So we're really, really excited about it.
Well, we have some pretty excited principal investigators, too.
And, oh, I bet that's true, yeah.
And I understand we have some tape of their reactions to what went on during the mission and the landing.
Great.
Well, we're really excited because our runs went particularly well. The processing went exactly according to plan. And in my case, I got an extra run in that was totally unexpected due to the interaction of the crew.
We're delighted with the way the zeolite crystal growth experiment went, how the furnace performed, and especially with the way the crew handled our experiment.
So a lot of analysis is done. The astronauts did a great job, and we were really happy about the successes we saw on the video camera downlinks.
It's really a great thrill to be able to finally do this experiment in space, to actually get downlink video and watch it being done in the glove box facility. Very exciting, very thrilling.
Being part of the mission, everything running so well, collecting all the science properly, having no malfunctions in the hardware, everything's just gone so flawlessly that it's almost beyond words.
Well, Roger, what's next?
Well, I don't know, Mike. I look at those guys and they are really pumped up, so we're really excited about that. I think the next part of our mission that we're, or our program that we're really excited about is to start to analyze this data and start to see how really significant the results are. We've got a lot of hope for the potential of what's coming out of this thing. So I say let's go for it.
All right. Thanks for joining us, Roger.
Thanks, Mike.
Again, that was USML-1 program scientist Dr. Roger Crouch. Well, this brings to a close the USML-1 edition of Today in Space. We hope we've been able to bring the important science down to Earth for you and to share with you the real excitement this historic mission has generated. On behalf of the entire Today in Space team, I'm Mike Wargo at NASA's Marshall Space Flight Center in Huntsville, Alabama, saying thanks for tuning in. We say goodbye with a look back on the highlights from the last few weeks in space.
3, 2, 1, 0, and liftoff of the Space Shuttle Columbia and the first extended duration mission, a stepping stone to space station freedom.
Program, Houston.
Roger, roll, Columbia.
Columbia, Houston, we're following you through post-insertion. You have a go for Spacelab activation.
The drop physics module overall is dedicated to studying the dynamics of liquid drops in microgravity.
I'm ready to start autoclave number 1 on the zeolite crystal growth.
Thanks for the info, Carl. Microgravity man, signing off.
Go for a higher duty cycle. The basic point is to get beyond the bifurcation point.
Copy that.
I'd like to have you check the electrodes on Bonnie, maybe perhaps before we take TV 1. good work, Gene.
And Spacelab Huntsville, we have module TV. Red, white, and blue looks great.
And I give my regards to the POC team at Marshall for the great job they're doing, and to the little over 100 investigators I've had the pleasure of working with.
Let's go ahead and hit a hard retract and see what happens.
Oh, we have one happy APS and CIC tonight.
Corbett 3 would just like to congratulate all of you on breaking the shuttle on orbit record.
Next to that is the crystal growth furnace, which now has the flexible glove box attached to the upper portion.